every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So today, let's just dive right in and talk about what God's got to do with any of this finding of our purpose. I know that, gosh, it's I've heard people say that we're living in a post-Christian world, that there are lots of people who don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God, who haven't given their lives to Christ, don't consider themselves Christian, and they want to find their purpose too. And I can understand that. I was raised by atheists. So I am intimately familiar with all of the reasons that people use to deny God and deny faith in God. And we all get our free will to do that. So this podcast and, you know, everything that I say, I'm sharing about my faith. I'm really not trying to proselytize or get anybody to believe the way I believe. I'm just sharing it because I've lived without God and I've lived with God, and I would never, ever go back to living without God, without my faith. But you get to choose whatever you want to do. God gave you free will, and I will too. So I'm just going to share with you the five reasons why I believe that we need God in order to fully achieve the good purpose for our lives. So the first one is about our identity, our real, true identity, our brokenness, our flaws, the ways that we're awesome. You've heard me say, I think we're flawsome. We're awesome and we're flawed at the same time. Both things can be true at the same time, and they are. Nobody's perfect. The thing about our identity is it's not random. It's not accidental that we have this unique in all the world, in all time identity. There's never, ever been another person precisely, exactly like you. This is proven by our DNA. It's proven by our fingerprints. They're unique. Those are the things that are just sort of outward evidence. But if you think about the way you feel about things, how certain things bother you that don't bother the next person at all, and stuff that bothers other people doesn't really, it's not a thing for you. You see things a certain way. You can look at a situation and see things that other people don't see. You can think that a situation means a certain thing that maybe the next person wouldn't pick up on. You have intelligences. So just innate abilities, things that you didn't go to school to learn how to do. You just know. Talents, your strengths, your weaknesses. All of these things are unique to you, this combination. So you might have other people that you have a lot in common with, but there's nobody else, and there never has been and there never will be, who shares exactly the same thoughts, feelings, perspective, intelligences, viewpoints, opinions. There's nobody else who's exactly like you. Your identity, that true identity, was authored by the creator of the universe. That's my belief. And God, I believe, specifically chose your biological mother, who carried the DNA, the genes of all of her ancestors, and your biological father carried the DNA of all of his ancestors. And I believe that God chose those people to create the masterpiece that's you. Now, those people might have thought that you were an accident. Those people might have not intended to have a baby. God made you. He chose those people to create you in a specific way. Just like mixing, I'm not good at mixing colors, but what is it, red and blue that turns purple? If you mix things together, something else comes out of it. So think about baking a cake. God took all of the good things from your mother and all of her ancestors, and all of the good things from your father and all of his ancestors, and mixed them together and added a sense of humor and added strength and added courage and resilience and resourcefulness. And I mean, all the character traits that you have in you, it's part of your God-authored identity. And everything that you have inside of you, everything that makes you uniquely you, is necessary to the fulfillment of your purpose. So my reason number one, that, you know, to answering the questions, what's God got to do with it, is God's the one who authored your identity. If you don't embrace that, then you may go through your whole life feeling like something's not quite right. Like you're not enough. Or like you're broken or too broken to be fixed. Like something's really wrong. Well, we have mental health diagnosis for everything nowadays. There's a word for everything. I'm not saying that's necessarily a wrong thing. But, you know, when somebody slaps a label on us, saying, well, you have attention deficit, or, and it doesn't have to be a mental health thing. It can just be a personality thing. I remember hearing, you're too loud. You're obnoxious. You're like a bull in a china shop. Be quiet. Well, I thought I was wrong. I thought I was wrong for being me. I tried so hard to be like other people. I tried to be like a quiet, sweet church, what I call a church lady. That didn't last for very long. I tried to be quiet and pensive. That didn't last for very long either. I mean, any time I would try to be like somebody else, I fail at it. Why? Because I'm not somebody else. I'm not wired to be somebody else. I'm wired to be me. And I get that not everybody will love me, and not everybody wants to be with me, and that's okay. And that's okay for all of us. Because if you're with people who really don't want to be around you, and they don't like you, and they just tolerate you, they're not your people. Your people think you're amazing. Your people will think you're awesome. And they love being around you, and they feel energized. They feel better when they're around you. Where I'm going with all this is that if we never really get to that place where we say, okay, I am who I am. I want to be the best version of me that I can possibly be, but I'm going to accept who I am. I've accepted. I'm loud. I laugh. Loud. I laugh a lot. I am always looking for the bright side. I've been told you're too optimistic. You always think of, you know, the most amazing thing that could possibly happen. And like it's a bad thing. I've been told that. And you think every good thing can happen if we just try hard enough. And then, you know, and then, but then when it doesn't, we feel like such losers because the amazing thing that you predicted didn't happen. And so, you know, I get it. It's real criticism. but this is who I am. And I get that not everybody can take a full dose of Rhonda. And that may be true for you too. But be okay with it instead of trying to change it. And I think this goes for all the aspects of our personality. Let me say again and reiterate, yes, be the best that you can possibly be. Whatever your good character traits are, lean into those things. If it's resilience, resourcefulness, if it's creativity, if it's empathy and caring for others, whatever it is, own it, be it, do it the best you possibly can. The same with your personality traits. Lean into who you are. Hopefully you'll acknowledge that you're not an accident. You're an intentional. You're a deliberate. You are a masterpiece. You were created by the creator of the universe. And you're not a mistake. There's no mistake about you. Number two, our experiences, good, bad, ugly, painful, fun, things we overheard that we weren't supposed to hear, things that we did hear and they hurt, things that we heard and they felt great, all of it, form our worldview, form our values and our beliefs. These paths were carved out for us. Now, that's not to say that we don't have free will. We do. We can all decide to go rob a bank this afternoon if we want to. We have free will. When I say our paths were carved out for us, though, there's always a choice. We can take the path as soon as we're able to take a path. Obviously, you have no choice when you're an infant and a toddler and so on. But if you think about the creator of the universe choosing the family to which you would be born into, I believe that that same creator who knows the number of hairs on your head also made arrangements for who your neighbors would be, who your teachers would be, who your friends would be, who your influences would be. Now, for those of you who were harmed by one of those people, we're going to talk about that in point number three. So let's set that aside just for a minute. And just think about the paths we've taken, the paths we could have taken and chosen not to. All of these things influenced our thinking and helped to form and shape us into the people we are today. It was a lot of arrangement, depending on how old you are, and it's still happening today. But if you think about the all the details of your life, if you've ever had a random meeting, let's say, with someone who turned out to become a great friend, if you think about the very first time that you met your spouse or the very first time that you met the person who became your closest friend, you know, those kinds of things. Think about it. There are so many times in our lives where we just happen to be at a certain intersection in our life at exactly the right time, at exactly the same time as someone else who we were supposed to meet. It's a lot of details that in our lives have fallen into place. If we really think about those things. So that's number two, our experiences and the paths that have been carved for us. The third thing that God has to do with our purpose and the fulfillment of it. This is huge. I mean, for me, this is huge because I experienced a lot of things, and you probably did too, that you wish hadn't happened, that you would have done anything to have prevented if you could. For me, both of my parents left. I was raised by abusive people. I mean, and some of the abuse was really crazy, like being burned and things like that. Like, just off the chart nuts. I've thought a lot about why these things happened to me. And if there's a God, remember, I was raised by atheists. So if there's a God, why would this God allow these things to happen to me? It would mean either there isn't a God, or there's a God and he's not good, or there's a God and he's not powerful enough to have prevented these things. Where I've landed with this at this place in my life now is to say, okay, God himself didn't do these things to me. People did. People with their own free will and could make their choices did harmful things to me. But where God comes into the picture is that he works all of it together for our good. If we'll allow him to, if we will have faith that he exists, if we will turn over our will, and basically exchange our free will for his will, for what he wants to see happen. And when we do that, it's remarkable. I mean, really, nothing short of miraculous. That God will take the broken pieces of our lives and use those things as the stepping stones to the fulfillment of his purpose for our lives. An example, I always give my examples of my life. It's the only life I have. So, you know, I keep using my examples, but I'm sure you have them too. Where something just amazingly worked out beautifully. Usually, it's eventually worked out beautifully. Usually, it's not instantaneous, inexplicable resolution to a seemingly impossible situation, which is also known as a miracle. You know, I think a lot of us have some Hollywood inspired ideas about what miracles are. And that's not to say that God doesn't do that kind of miracle. He does. I've actually had one of those in my life. I'll tell you about it sometime. But most of the miracles that I've experienced and that I've seen in the lives of other people are things that just eventually worked out perfectly. So the example from my life is I was homeless in the second grade. I was about 8 years old when the little shack that we lived in was destroyed by fire. And so we lived in the park and it was hard. And I felt dirty. I actually was dirty all the time, but I felt ashamed. And this lasted for, I don't know, 5 or 6 months that we were homeless and without a shower or a bath and with not enough food to eat and hungry. I mean, it was just awful. But I went to school every day, so I experienced the teasing and being ostracized for being so dirty and gross and wearing the exact same little sundress that I was wearing the day of the fire. I wore the exact same thing every single day for months. Well, when I say God takes the pieces of our brokenness and uses them to build the path to his plans and purpose for our lives, I know that God arranged for the very first job that I ever got to be in an insurance agency. And when I learned what insurance was, and that when somebody's house is destroyed by fire, that the insurance company pays to put them up in another house and pays to replace their clothes, and then in the meantime is rebuilding their house, I was stunned. I didn't know there was such a thing. We didn't have insurance on the little shack or on our clothes or any of the things that were destroyed. They were just gone. So when I found out about insurance, I thought, oh my gosh, if somebody has the right insurance, they're not going to have to experience what I experienced. The pain and the shame of literally sleeping on the ground and being dirty at night and being scared and hot in the summer and cold in the winter. I mean, I didn't want anybody to ever feel like that. So I threw myself into this thing called insurance, and it became a 40-year career. And it really wasn't that long down the line that I started my own business, where I took what I knew about insurance and I combined it with my passion for helping children who have been abused. So God's plan and purpose for my life of protecting and defending the good people and organizations that cared for abused children and analyzing the way kids and caregivers get injured or killed in out-of-home placement, foster care, child welfare, and then building risk management programs, employee training programs around what we knew were the triggers for tragedies, and then thereby keeping kids safe. I wouldn't have done any of that if I hadn't been a homeless 8-year-old who had a burning desire to not let anybody else go through what I'd been through. So that's how God helps us to not waste our pain if we will let Him. He will mine the nuggets of gold out of everything that we've been through. And then we can cooperate and collaborate with Him to use those things to the fulfillment of His plans and purpose for our lives. So that's number three. Number four. You do not have to be a Christian in order to find your purpose and live your purpose. You can do it without God. This is evidenced by people who, for example, have tremendous talent and use their talent to the acclaim of many. I mean, if you think about some of the performers, think about your favorite actress or actor, or your favorite band or singer or whatever. Think about people who are outrageously successful using their talents. They may be full-blown atheists. They may not have any faith in God. They may never have turned to God for help. They may never have turned to God for help. And yet, there they are, experiencing what the world calls success and using their talent. So you can do that, and you can reach a certain level. You can get to a certain level. There's a limit on it without God. With God, you can absolutely fully achieve His purpose for your life. Without Him, you could only go so far. It may be amazingly far as what the world thinks is success, but you know, we've talked about that before. Real success is having peace and joy and healthy relationships and a sense of wellness and contentedness that comes only from that sense of satisfaction that you get from living your purpose, and financial provision for doing whatever you were born and formed perfectly matched to do. when we turn over our free will to God and say, your will be done in our lives, then buckle up, buttercup, because that's when it gets good. That's when things happen that you can't make happen on your own. That's where number five really comes in. The full achievement of your purpose can only be accomplished with God, because there are some doors that only He can open. And there are some doors that you shouldn't walk into and paths that you shouldn't go down that only God can close. He'll only close them, though, if you give Him permission to do so. If you say things like, well, deliver me from the desire to do that, to go here, to go there, to use this drug, to drink this alcohol, to eat a gallon of ice cream at a time, whatever it is that we do to make ourselves feel better, deliver me from the desire for that. I want your will, not mine. Really, it comes down to, this is number five, really, it comes down to getting to a place in our lives where we say, all right, okay, God, I'm going to pursue your purpose for my life. I should say, really, you, God, and your purpose for my life with reckless abandon. I'm going to do this to the exclusion of everything else. I'm going to let everything that's not from you and part of your purpose fall away. Sometimes that's everything and everyone. Sometimes there are people in your life who would hold you back. Now, that's not to say that you quit loving them or whatever, but maybe you quit taking their advice. Maybe you quit listening to their criticism of you that makes you feel like you can't do the thing that you feel called to do. Because in level five, or at this fifth point, is really where we pay attention to what we feel called to do, to really, really give ourselves fully to who we feel called to be. And then doing that. I'll add, for me as a Christian, that means staying within the bumpers, the guidelines, staying in my lane, and living according to the guidelines that God has given us in His Word, in the Bible. That's what that means to me. Because that's how we avoid train wrecks, honestly. That's how we avoid taking wrong turns. That's how we avoid stepping off the path that leads right straight into our purpose and getting over into stuff that is going to do nothing but distract us and diminish the fulfillment of our purpose. It's at this point, this level, where, I don't know, for me, maybe not for everybody, but this is where I began to develop a sense of urgency about fulfilling God's purpose for my life. That's what led me to start this podcast. That's what's led me to write my blog articles and my books. And it's about listening, really listening to the leading of God's Holy Spirit, which I have to say, I mean, I wish it was an email with bullet points that are prioritized of, you know, which one goes first and which one's next and which one's last and so on and so forth. That's just, at least for me, not how it works. God whispers, He doesn't yell. Dagnabbit. I wish. I wish that He would just, you know, yell loud and clear. But it's quiet. It's more of a whisper. It's more, for me at least, it's a feeling in my heart. It's settle. And at least for me, it requires me carving out time that I'm going to be quiet and I'm going to really intentionally listen for the leading of God, the whispers of God, because otherwise, the phone is ringing and the phone is dinging with texts and the computer is beeping, telling me that I have an appointment coming up and, you know, all of it, emails, videos. I mean, there's just so much that can distract us that we have to exercise our free will to dial down the noise in the world and choose to sit and have a conversation with the creator of the universe, with God himself, and with his son, Jesus. And that's when you'll hear the clearest and best response to what you were created to do, what your next thing is. And that's when it gets fun and it gets exciting and you can't wait for the next thing because anything could happen. So that's it. Those are my five reasons for why we need God in order to really find and fully achieve our purpose. So I hope that you'll share this with somebody who you feel like could benefit from it. I hope that you'll subscribe and join me again next Sunday. And I'd love to hear from you. There's a link in the description that will allow you to send a voice note, or you can go to my website, rhonda.org, and there's a contact page, and you can send me a note there. And I will love to hear from you. All right. Have a great week. See you next week.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.